All right, folks, welcome back, and we are going to continue to talk about another pro-life topic, a great event that just happened. It is the March for Life in Chicago, and we have a great guest with us. She is the March for Life Chicago Board of Directors President, Don Fitzpatrick. Talk to us about the event, some of the people that were there, the atmosphere, those kinds of things. Don, thank you so much for fitting us into your busy schedule. How are you?
Oh, I'm great. How are you?
Oh, we're so blessed and great to have you on the show. And, you know, I love it. Let's start with, I got the presser in front of me. Our folks are working on publishing that right now as we speak on the website. But it says, quote, record turnout. So talk about that a little bit, about who was on site, the numbers, different folks, different walks of life.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, our March for Life Chicago is organized by a group of board of directors who are from sponsoring pro-life organizations from around Chicago. And, you know, we all certainly are there to help make sure that it happens. And then we have a number of other organizations who sponsor us to make sure that we have the resources we need in order to put it on. And then this year, we estimate we had well over 6,000 people in Federal Plaza, downtown Chicago. Now, every year since we started the format that we have, which was 5 years ago, every year it's grown. So the first year we did this format, we had about 1,000 people. So that gives you an idea of how much it's grown in 5 years.
Incrementally every year, it sounds like. So,
yes.
And great names. I mean, obviously you talk about Pat McCaskey, for instance, from the Bears being there, kind of opening things up and things like that. I mean, what were the kind of like the words there to kind of get the crowd going?
Well, you know, he always talks, he always has a poem, and he had just a delightful poem that he feels like it's a way to inspire people to move forward. And he has a little bit of a gift for poetry. So, you know, it's really kind of neat to see somebody who is a longtime owner of an NFL team. You know, his family's owned that team since he was born, you know, and to see people like that, especially with, you know, all kinds of things going on in the news about the NFL and some of the things they do that don't seem so impressive, to see that he's willing to stand up for life like he is. And you know, he's been consistent. Every year we've done this in the last 5 years, he's been speaking at the march. And then he stayed after and did a little after party with some of the students from Students for Life of America. So, you know, he's very committed. It's incredible.
Well, and it's great to see Mr. McCaskey step out. I mean, like you say, he's just putting it all on the line, because the movement of society and culture is away from that. To be an NFL owner and to kind of still be that confident and strong as a pro-lifer is just great to see. Just so encouraging.
Right, right. So it was incredible to have him there along with everybody else that we had speaking, certainly.
Speak to some of the politicians that are there. I know Illinois State Senator, State Rep Ives was there. You obviously had Lipinski, and Smith was talked about in the National March of Life. So we have some pro-lifers out there, and they're trying to do some things here and there. What was it like for these groups that were there at your event?
Well, you know, we did have Congressman Lipinski, who's a Democrat, and Congressman Roskam, who's a Republican. They're both are two of our you know, United States congressmen, and they've come out just about every year, the two of these guys. So they're always committed to what we're doing. And then we had State Rep Ives, which was a little bit of a surprise. She announced that she was going to be there, and so it was very nice to have her also. And she has an incredible story herself that she didn't share this weekend, but, you know, I've seen her speak at other events and talk about the reason she's pro-life, and she had a difficult pregnancy and was advised to have an abortion, and then she didn't do that. But, and you know, and it was a you know, certainly a child that was born with issues that didn't survive. But she talks about how important it is to her that she didn't choose abortion for that child. You know, so she has a personal stake in this, and that she's willing to share that kind of a intimate situation with people is just so incredible. So they, you know, they're all three of them fired up, excited, got the crowd excited. And you know, they, as they checked in before the march to tell us they were there, just the excitement in their face and the fact that it was cold out and they're all bundled up and they're jumping up and down. And, you know, it's nice to see our elected officials excited to be pro-life and loving life.
Well, I think Congressman Lipinski is quoted as saying in this, you know, being pro-life is being pro-woman. And so we're in the middle mm-hmm. of, you know, this, you know, the Women's March kind of being,
right.
you know, just right. masquerading as not being a political march. And then you have, you know, this different spin of the Me Too movement and Hollywood mm-hmm. and celebrities where it's just totally taken out of context, one of the most right. you know, heinous and grievous things in our society. I know I began this week's show with the survey that came out of India. You know, 15.6 million abortions in 2015 alone, 20% more than estimates. And as I tried to point out was, you know, what they did was they took the data from the sales of abortion pills and things like that mm-hmm. and realized that the abortion was so much more common. I said, imagine what it's really like in America, because these pills are on campuses in yeah. vending machines. So we have no idea how bad it really, really is.
No, because people can just go ahead and take those pills, and then maybe the numbers don't get reported accurately. That's been my biggest concern since they've been doing that, is how many are really happening. Of course, one is too many, but when we're starting to talk about millions and then how much they grow just because somebody can take a pill to kill their child, it's horrible.
It's just shocking how underreported and mm-hmm. and off the radar screen it is. We're talking with Don Fitzpatrick about the March of Life Chicago, which was this weekend, and it mm-hmm. is just amazing turnout, amazing folks there on the ground. And you know, it talks about this day and age where we see now so many different bizarre laws and weird legislative moves for abortion. I remember we did an interview and I asked this person, and I said, you know, when is it not okay? Can you give me a line? And they just refused to give a line. And I just got to be honest, Don, I have such a hard time with, I'm actually advocating like, just give me 20 weeks. Can we just get to 20? I came from a science background. I can show you the research of pain and that kind of thing. I've had hardcore atheists tell me, look, once they can feel pain, they have a brainstem or whatever. So how about we just start there? In New Mexico, we refuse to draw lines. And some of these states, we're like, we can't get a line at 6 months, 7 months. This is crazy.
Well, you know what's really, really sad is I heard a report on a radio station last week about a group who is actually trying to bring legislation forward to change the way that we kill lobsters before we eat them, because we are boiling them and they're in pain. Same thing with, I read a study, I started to do some research on that and found that there's a whole organization in Great Britain about the pain of crustaceans, and they talk about the fact that, you know, we're inhumane in how we kill lobsters and crabs, and I'm, you know, from Maryland, loving crabs. It's like one of our favorite things. So if we're so concerned that we're even considering bringing legislation forward to stop the pain of crustaceans, and we can't even do that for human beings, I mean, how awful is that?
Well, we jail people for just their activities with pets. I mean, you can leave your dog in the car with the windows rolled up here in Florida and be arrested because it's, you know, animal abuse. But at the baby's 32 weeks and we're too busy trying to discuss the mom and not the baby moving around. And I will say this. Let me ask you this, Don. Let's transition to this.
Okay. Yeah, let's do it.
Where are we at on some adoption regulations? I mean, we really just kind of lose mm-hmm. focus in some ways, right, where the conversation gets so obsessed over when and why and how and her rights. And we end up getting away from, you know, because I know when my wife and I pursued it a few years ago before we had grandchildren, it was like, well, mm-hmm. we had been divorced too many times before. Like, she was one and I was one. They add them together, you don't qualify, you know, and it was so expensive and all this. When can we get to the point of red tape and say, listen, give me the baby, and then when I do something wrong, then you deal with me. And
right. No, but we'd rather kill the baby in utero rather than, yes. So, and, you know, and it's true. I know so many families who would love to adopt a child, whether they have never been able to have a child or whether they already have children and they'd like to add one, or they'd like to reach out to a family in need and take care of that child, but they're not able to because of the red tape and the expense and the fact that there's just not enough babies available. When you realize if we've killed 60 million babies since 1973 legally, how many of those children could we have easily placed with families that wish that they had a child, that long for a child, that are ready and eager. And, you know, and I think it's funny because I've seen a lot of the chatter about the marches, and that's one of the first things that somebody on the opposing side will say on a page or in comments is, well, you adopt a child and then we can talk. It's like, well, you don't understand. People are willing. They're eager. They're begging for it.
Absolutely. And as we leave you, Dawn, it's great to be able to fit you into our schedule. Plug your website, social media, anything people can do to reach out to you, learn more about your organization as well.
Sure. So you can go to www.marchforlifechicago.org and see all the information about what was at the march. And of course, once we start to have information for next year, then it will be there. And also, March for Life Chicago has a Facebook page, and there is just tons of stuff going on there. You can see an entire video of the entire march and how beautiful it was, along with photos and just tons of information. So that Facebook page is a great place to go.
Well, it's great to have you on, and thank you again for your time.
All right. Thank you so much. It was great to be here.